Hi, everyone. I'm going to sort of introduce the report, which, as Emily nicely said, is about the intersections of games play and journalism. And then I'm going to have a wonderful conversation with three experts in the field. We have Heather Chaplin, who's the director of new New School Journalism and Design program. We have CC Wei, who has sort of extensively researched games, I think, for both personal and professional interests, but is partially as her professional job of being the application developer for ProPublica. And we have Nicole Leffel, who is a member of BuzzFeed's games team, which designs playful interactives and games for that particular company. So we'll have a conversation and then open it up to everyone to ask whatever questions they want about the report. And to let you know a little bit about myself, I am Maxwell Foxman, says it there, and I'm a PhD candidate here in communications at the Journalism School, and my research interests have primarily surrounded games and play in sort of unusual situations, ranging from politics to social media. And really, the germination of the idea of this report actually came long before I proposed it as a report to Tau. It really started in 2012 with this. I don't know if people remember this, but back in 2012, the Israeli Defense Forces, shortly before taking military action in the Gaza Strip, changed their public relations blog to have a sort of game element. They created a game where you received points and badges and prizes for disseminating the information that they were giving. And I thought it was interesting because almost immediately after they started doing this, the blogosphere sort of erupted with these criticisms of the sort of crass actions of the Israeli Defense Forces. But what was particularly interesting for me was this was during a sort of craze in gamification when legitimate news organizations ranging from the Huffington Post to Mashable to Google News were all doing something very similar to the Israeli Defense Force. So it brought this question, that sort of contradiction. Why is it that when the Israeli Defense Force public relations blog does this, it's bad, but when Huffington Post does it, it's part of this new wild craze? Why is that occurring? How, when, and why should games be involved with journalism? And so really that drove the central questions of this report for me, which are fourfold. First, I was interested, as I said, in how games are being used by digital journalists outside of these crazes of both gamification, news games, a more current interest in quizzes. You know, what is actually happening? What are journalists actually doing and making involving games in play? And I was also interested in how practices of journalistic practices might be changing due to games in play. We, after all, you know, the journalistic industry, just like every other, has members of it that have grown up playing video games, playing games. And I wondered, you know, and you also see games being, you know, embraced by a wide variety of institutions, education, healthcare, politics. Were journalists additionally embracing games, or were they, you know, reacting to them differently than those other institutions? I was interested when games in play should not be used, something that, you know, understanding the limits and challenges of incorporating games into journalistic practice and design. And then last but not least, I was interested in, you know, this sort of more meta question. What qualifies as a game to a journalist? Because frankly, when I mention this report to most journalists, I get a response that's usually something like what you see on the left. This is Budget Hero. It lasted about 4 years. It was a news game that allowed any person to sort of play at balancing the national budget. It was lauded by many scholars, journalists, etc. Cost a fair amount of money to maintain, and was a collaboration between a number of philanthropic organizations, journalistic institutions, including American Public Media. And it sort of looks like a video game. But when I brought up that same question to Jack Shepard, who's the Buzz editor at BuzzFeed, he pointed me to one of his own articles called "Can You Make It Through This Post Without Saying Aw?" Now, this doesn't look exactly like a game, or a video game at least. It's very text heavy, but there are rules, there's competition, there's something game-like about it. So I sort of instinctively felt that games surrounded and play surrounded a vast array of products and issues beyond sort of the news game model. So just to give you an idea of what I did, I conducted 40 interviews with practicing journalists, and I tried to cover a wide array of journalists and people working in journalism, graphic design, development, editorial, technology. I did long-form interviews over the phone, in person, etc., visited a few sites, and I tried to also speak not just to journalists, but to serious game designers who often design news games, serious games. I tried to speak to educators in game labs and journalists and journalism schools to get an idea of how they are incorporating these practices in game design into education. And I tried to cover, you know, a wide array of journalistic institutions ranging from Mother Jones, WNYC, The New Yorker, Miami Herald, really as far a net as I could cast. And I even did a little bit of historical research on games and play, which I'll mention shortly. So to give you an idea of my findings, maybe I should start with this largest question first. What qualifies as a game to journalists? And I don't know if I have a perfect answer to that question, but I often found when I brought up games to journalists, it was a very polarizing word. Some journalists felt very strongly that games should be incorporated into practices and that we should be using games in every way possible. Others felt very strongly the other way. But when I mentioned something different, like play or fun or toys, a term which I know Heather Chaplin has more to say than I do, they had a wider array of examples and a wider array of opinions than the sort of polarizing or maybe even stigmatized feeling that surrounded games. For instance, one journalist pointed me towards this infographic as a playful infographic. This was the depth of the problem. It was an infographic by the Washington Post. And what was playful for this particular journalist was exactly what you're seeing here, that the infographic was designed for being read on a web browser and really made use of this sort of interactive scrolling feature to make it, you know, a little bit more engaging and to really highlight how difficult finding the downed Malaysian airliner of this past year was. So that's, for them, this was playful. Games, by contrast, as I've just said, really was much more of a lightning rod. But this actually wasn't all that new, I found when I did historical research. This is a picture from Highline, the crossword craze of the 1920s, for those of you who didn't know. Back in the 1920s, the crossword was all the rage. There was dresses made and clothing designed after it. There were musicals written about it. Everyone loved the crossword. But actually, if you look at the history of the crossword, some of the same lightning rod issues that surround video games today and the incorporation of games into journalistic products were right there. Technology allowed the crossword to come into being. Innovations in print technology, the mobility that the newspaper allowed, all sort of helped the crossword come into being. There was user feedback and iterability. The crossword puzzle changed over time. It didn't look like, from 1910 to 1920, it shifted drastically. There was incentivization. There were prizes and contests levied by newspapers for their own profit using crosswords to make some money. And there were limitations. The New York Times originally wanted a serious crossword every Sunday and did not succeed in doing it because it just didn't work for the medium. And finally, it was part of this larger news bundle of not just hard news, but entertainment, classified ads, etc. So I ended up, trying to come up with my own composite definition and ended up using the term play for this report as opposed to games, partially because I think it gets at the heart of what I was trying to see, which was how journalists were experimenting, iterating, changing, toying with their journalistic products in response to audience and user feedback. So what did I find? First, I found that in terms of what is happening in the journalism industry now, I found that many of the games and playful products go along the lines of either features or stock formats. Those are sort of the two poles. To give you an idea of what those two things look like, on the left you see the sort of now famous dialect quiz by the New York Times, which was built around a very specific data set. It was like a feature. There was specific content that was somewhat that could be approached playfully in the form of a quiz, and it was made into that. On the other hand, you have something what I call a stock format. These are templates, frameworks, tools that are developed to be used across a wide variety of content. And what's sort of interesting if you compare these two examples is that even though they fall on those two poles, they can cover very similar information, in this case, your dialect or American accent. And then I broke that down into four clusters of different types of products. You have points, badges, and prizes, these, quote, gamified elements that, for me at least, are like, could be considered the most elemental stock formats. They could be put on almost anything, and about 3 years ago, they were put on almost everything. You have quizzes and questions, which are I think, an interesting subject, partially because they are text-heavy, but also because the barrier of entry to play, quote, play, is very low. We can, almost all of us, answer questions and know exactly what we're doing. Moving along, you have something that I call situation-specific designs. These are designed around specific content and usually incorporated into larger packages of news information. So, you know, could you be a medalist was part of the Guardian's larger coverage of the Olympics. I found that the 2012 elections were sort of half a dozen to a dozen news organizations had something playful built into their election coverage in one way or another. And then finally, you have sort of the news game or game world, this traditional, maybe what journalists think of as games, which I just want to emphasize is very much in the eye of the beholder. And here, this game, Sweatshop, was built by not journalists but serious game designers with journalistic input, and is supposed to give sort of the experience and give an understanding of the system that is a sweatshop. So, as I said, I was interested partially in this concept of what products were being made that were playful, but I was also interested in the practices and trying to understand how play is being incorporated into the making of news every day. And I actually thought Brian Boyer, the NPR visuals editor, really captured this ethos well. But not talking about play, but talking about harnessing the love of his audience. And you can see from this quote that he really considered himself to have a special relationship with the audience, with the NPR audience, and was clearly building products with that in mind. But my case study, which makes up a large portion of the report, is BuzzFeed. And BuzzFeed is a very fascinating office for people that go there. It is a very playful place. You know, the boardrooms are named after pictures of cats. There are people playing ping pong, and there's Connect Four. But that wasn't what interested me as much as how this experimental, iterative quality of making news was being built into their everyday practices. And I focused on the games team at BuzzFeed to really give myself, to really use an example that I knew would be oriented towards games and to get an understanding of how these practices were happening there, with the idea of seeing it also in the context of a larger company. And what I found was that the games team very much was doing what I've been describing. They were creating products very quickly and creating formats very quickly, much quicker than any game studio, often within weeks to months. And then they were releasing them and then tweaking them and changing them over time based on audience feedback. So to give you sort of a concrete example of that Nicole pointed me to, here is their roulette format, and the format basically is that you hit that start button, and it produces a list of random words, from considerate to strong, whatever it might be, and it lands on that word, and that is the word that best describes you, and then you share it. So they released this and then toyed with the same format and changed it over time to eventually make it include pictures, so what book you should start reading next. Here you have the picture of His Dark Materials. That's what I happen to land on. And then eventually, even though it won't be super obvious in this picture, they added animation for creating your own spooky monster, I assume around Halloween. So that is it sort of shows how products evolve and change and how these formats change over time within BuzzFeed. And even though this is sort of one format example from the games team, the impression I got talking to others at BuzzFeed, Jack Shepard, who I mentioned earlier, was that this happened also within the context of the company at large. For instance, the now increasingly famous quizzes, they start out quite unpopular and were sort of, as he put it, left on the back burner to be tweaked with and changed over a matter of years before they really sort of reached their apex of popularity. And Shepard, in terms of encouraging his own editorial staff, has all sorts of games and practices that he's built into his own work. For instance, he has sprints where he encourages his editors to make as many games as possible, or as many features as possible around a particular format. That has produced a number of different things as well. So the way that they measure this, though, the way that they sort of judge and change is absolutely tied to user feedback. So I think most people know that BuzzFeed is sort of hardwired to measure the shareability of their content. And here you could see their sort of dashboard, which tracks both seed and viral content. And what I think is interesting here is that implicitly, if not explicitly, what's happening at BuzzFeed is a kind of playtesting, that they are looking at and changing their products based on user feedback. And similar to a game designer who might, you know, change their game if it's not playing well, if the, you know, a game is only as good as if it's being played, right? They are changing their content in a very similar manner. And this happens across the company, not just in terms of editorial or in terms of the games team, but you could even look at the way that they've split up the company as being in response to this sort of user feedback and metrics. And to that end, I wanted to look a little bit at the business of games and to see if there were any corollaries or worthwhile lessons that could be drawn from it, as the games industry is doing pretty well in terms of moving from, you know, physical products to digital products. And so I sort of mapped out a wide variety of different games business models. You know, you have something like Destiny, a AAA game, probably what a lot of us think of when we think of console games. It was the most expensive game ever made by a studio that's only going to make one or two or three games a year, and with, you know, budgets up in the millions. Next to it, one of my personal favorites, Two Dots, might be an example of a freemium game. You download the game for free and you get, you can pay for extra content, extra lives to play it more, etc. But what I found sort of across the board with this is that games business models are increasingly being built around the ability to monitor the actions of players and to be able to see from game, you know, as people play, what's happening, how they're playing, in what ways they're playing, and to change the product sometimes from download to download. So when you get that new version of the game on your phone, the game has been changed based on user feedback and monitoring. And I think that this is starting to happen in some ways in the news industry. Things like the New York Times Now app or the NPR One app both are taking into account the platforms in which we're engaging with news, but maybe they aren't doing exactly the same thing as the video game industry. And sort of to that end, I think that there are challenges to integrating this sort of playful approach into news. Culture is a big issue. I had one educator I interviewed who described to me that when she asked her students, these were undergrad journalism students, if they played games, 10% of them raised their hands roughly. So there seems to be some disconnect there. Brand is an issue, though I want to add the caveat that when I spoke to Tasneem Raja, who's from Mother Jones, she was quick to say that particular brand works very well. It's always been playful. So it embraces some of the playful formats she's come up with. And then cost in terms of time, in terms of effort, in terms of skills, either hiring hiring and bringing in skills or using the skills within the office are both challenges. But there's practical examples of this being sort of combated, having these challenges be overcome. And I wanted to point to the Miami Herald and WLRN's Talanasty game, which is an ethics game looking at the entrenchment and political corruption in Tallahassee, Florida, and in the state politics there. Now, what's interesting here is that, there are these challenges, both to brand. Money was an issue. You know, this sort of game can't be made every single week by the Miami Herald. And in terms of skills, some of the people that created the game have now moved on to other companies, so how it's going to be maintained is a worthwhile question. But the fact that they chose the subject of sort of entrenched political corruption, I want to give them a lot of credit for, because it is something that can be used again and again. And in fact, even though this game has been made in 2013, it has been used in subsequent election cycles. So I conclude the report with a few suggestions, starting with practical ones. The first one that I say is to think like a game designer, adding the huge caveat that most game designers have spent years honing their craft. So this is sort of think like a game designer light, but emphasizing looking at news product creation and news content creation flexibly, thinking that there is that possibility of play in what's being built, using a wide variety. Okay. Using a wide variety of formats and having those formats available to be used and reused is another important factor. Iterating, not assuming that these formats or the content that you make is static or the best version of it, but constantly changing it over time. And finally, playtesting, both within the newsroom, which is something that BuzzFeed does, or again, with your audience, who is a valuable resource. And I think there are implications to what this means to stories for journalists and what it means our relationship with the audience is. But I think that maybe we could talk more about that during Q&A. I also have a couple of technical suggestions. The biggest one is that journalists are obviously not game designers. So rather, for practicing journalists who have not specialized in games, a wise idea might be to not assume you're going to make the next and best greatest game, but to use the skills within a newsroom to your advantage, be they editorial, photograph, whatever it might be. And I also recommend the use of open source software. I think that a number of companies are making their formats available on places like GitHub, and I think that that's incredibly valuable because it creates a repository of formats that then other journalistic institutions can use. And in addition to that, it starts to deal with issues of preservation, which I think are worth bringing up maybe in the Q&A. And then also I recommend playing with free software. Free software that comes out and sort of new and in its infancy might be a way to play with content. An example of this might be seen in the Times Haiku, which for those of you who don't know, Jacob Harris made this sort of one day out of a little bit of boredom. And it's a little bot that scrapes the New York Times every day and creates a little haiku. And it's been placed on, it was placed on the Tumblr platform, partially because the Tumblr platform at the time was sort of a new, relatively new product and could be a place to just see what happened with it. And Harris did similar things with the Twitter, with the Times Twitter profile a couple years before. So just to conclude, I think that, you know, if this report can point towards anything and something that I think is in the back of my head as I went through my research is that we're looking at a news environment, obviously, where the way we both disseminate and receive news is changing drastically, and that often news is placed, and this was something that came out in a lot of my interviews too, where news is placed alongside social media, you know, other games, other forms of content. And it doesn't just have to be Twitter feeds or news feeds. This is just sort of the environment that we're engaging with our news in. And I think that, you know, framing this change in the context of play might be one way to start to deal with these issues. So with that, I thank you, and I look forward to the conversation that we're all going to have. Okay. So, yes. I guess at this point, if you guys don't mind coming up, we'll chat. All right, so maybe I can start with a broader question, which is to see how much you agree with or want to push against this finding that I found that games as a medium have a certain stigma within the journalistic community. Do you think that's something that is true? And if you do, do you have any advice on how these sort of stigmas should be counteracted? Or is this something that is generational? Is this something that, you know, we won't even be talking about in 10 years? I was just wondering if you could tell me what you think.
Right
there.
Can I just say how cool it is? I've never been on a panel that was three women talking about games. Well done.
Yay.
Well, I'll start. So, you know, the stigma against games and journalism has been really interesting for me in the sense that I have never personally experienced a situation in which I'm trying to sort of sell games are a valuable tool for journalists to use, and then immediately got sort of very negative pushback. Hmm. However, it is something that I keep hearing happens to other people, right? And it was one of the things that came up when I was writing my first article about news games at all, in which I had started it with this lengthy like defense of why games are useful and the many angles of how many people are now playing games that were before, and then it just all got cut because my editor, as well as the editor of our partner news organization, said, we don't have to do this because the stigma isn't there. I was like, oh, well, all right. And after it came out, there was no feedback, right, that it needed to be there. But maybe anyone who's already reading about it already finds value in it. I don't know.
I haven't experienced much stigma, but I guess our writers tend to skew a little bit younger than other locations. So for us, it's probably the opposite. People, our editors are really excited to work with games and experimental formats. And usually it's us having to put the brakes on their expectations rather than the other way around.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would say that there is. Just quickly for background, I feel like I have a complicated relationship to that question because I started covering video games in 2001 when that was just considered like completely insane and career suicide and no mainstream venues were really covering games then. So I'm still somewhat in shock that like I'm here at Columbia having a serious conversation about games in the news. So I can both see this like tremendous strides that games have made and towards being completely accepted. On the other hand, I recently did a bunch of interviews with people in newsrooms about some of the possibilities that I see in games and why weren't people doing it. And I think there is it's a huge cultural issue within newsrooms themselves that anything that's considered frivolous just doesn't go with the sobriety that is needed for news, which is a serious business. So yeah, I think it exists.
Yeah, I think to that end, I'd be interested in knowing first, again, on that note of advice to future journalists, to people who are going to be entering in newsrooms excited about these sort of prospects and about being maybe a little bit more frivolous, what advice you would give to that journalist about what they should do, how they should approach the subject. I know that you've spoken a little bit about toys and using that term partially to get over some of, maybe not the exact stigmas we're talking about, but other stigmas about games. And also I'm wondering if this is something that you deal with in the journalism and design program, and if that factors in some ways with, sort of, if you have people coming in with their own stigmas there, and if games come up as a point of conversation.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would first, before even beginning to answer that, not necessarily start with the assumption that games are always a great thing to do in a newsroom. And that, to me, it's not convincing people that it's okay to be frivolous, but rather the idea that there are certain things, not all things, but certain things that games or what I've started calling playable models are really, really good at. So maybe it might be useful to tease that apart a little bit. I don't know what you guys think.
Yeah, no. Well, I totally agree with that, right? So I feel like when journalists decide to tell any story with any medium, right, it's not to say that when I'm looking at photography or videography that I would say, this is definitely the route we have to take every time, and I need to convince everyone that at any point this is something you could do. But rather, there is a time and a place in which games really could be the most powerful storytelling tool, but people sort of don't consider that an option or don't consider that they could take that route. And sort of those are the moments, I feel like, where we could do a lot of convincing and say, hey, this would add something that your other methods of storytelling could not bring to the table.
Sure.
I think it's the same danger of all the innovation that's happening in news as people start to go crazy about bells and whistles or the newest thing. Sometimes a 500-word story that's written is the best way to go, but sometimes it's not the best way to go, and is a game or a simulation or some kind of playable model sometimes going to be a better way than telling a story linearly in text or even in photographs?
So our games team doesn't focus on more news games. We are firmly centered right now in the frivolous content, so we don't usually have to work against that pressure, though we do have the same. For us, many times it's a game or a sort of a toy-like format still isn't the best option. So if many times the reason that lists work so well is because people want to know what they're getting into, they want to see a list, and then they want to be done with it. So I think a lot of times we don't want our editors to necessarily be shopping around for a format just for the sake of having a you know, the bells and whistles, though at the same time we do value that experimentation. So we try to match them up with something that maybe pushes the edges of the box a little bit, but doesn't isn't something that they should be using one of our, you know, standard CMS formats for, because that's a lot faster for them to do.
So I guess I'm interested that all three of you have sort of highlighted a kind of personal barometer that you all have for saying, okay, well, at some times this is really going to work, and at some times it's really not going to work. And I'm sure that this goes, you know, that this really comes from whatever content you happen to be in, you know, getting at a particular time. But I'm wondering, you know, can you describe that barometer a little bit? Because I think I'm still interested in, you know, I've heard, and I'm sure that many have heard, that games are very good at describing systems. Games are very good at allowing you to personally experience an event. But I'm also wondering, outside of that, especially when I highlight some of the sort of lighter, more playful interactives that I described in the report and that I'm describing here, I guess I'm trying to better understand the barometer outside of those stereotypes. Like, how do you come to judge, okay, this is really going to work as something playful, this is really like a good idea, or when do you slam on the brakes and say, well, this is terrible, this is definitely not going to work, and when do you compromise, I guess, would be the third version of that. And all of you are coming from such different places with this, you know, I imagine that, you know, I've heard a little bit of this from Nicole, but also how do you teach that barometer, and how have you experienced that at ProPublica in the development of apps? If anyone wants to. Is there no barometer?
I would say for me there's two things, or two core ideas that are at tension there. First is, they have the writer that we're working with has to want it really badly, and by that I mean, for us to turn around and package a game takes considerably longer than how long it would take them to potentially repurpose a lot of that content into something that's already available to them that they can like sit down at the CMS and make that day. So if it's an idea that they're really passionate about that they want to see through over a couple weeks, even to like up to like 4 or 6 weeks. To get that made, that's like the first big hurdle for us. And the second one is that we try to make sure that that the format adds a certain delight to the content. So if it's something that is truly more fun for like a person to sit down and play, or gives them something surprising, or like a little boost to their day, versus like what they're outside of what they might have been expecting when they came to the page, that's usually a good hint for us that it's worth pursuing and getting in there and creating something that's much more custom than what they would otherwise create.
So ProPublica is a very interesting place in that we are a nonprofit investigative journalism organization. So when it comes to games or articles or literally anything that we create, it has to be investigative in nature. And so, from my perspective, in that angle, right, there's sort of two issues that jump out immediately for when you really have to figure out, even if there is a beautiful, complex model for you to play and for you to explore using a game, two issues of like whether or not this is a good idea anyway. The first one is sort of accuracy, right? So anything that I model in the system that people could take away as the message has to be accurate in the real system. And it's possible for me to present something that gives you the gist of it, but might give you sort of some misconceptions of how things actually work, and that would be a problem for us. And then the second issue is sort of respect, right? So oftentimes what we're investigating involves sort of people's lives being ruined on many different levels, or some sort of physical harm or emotional trauma, right? And so when you put it to a game, it's possible to do it well and to do it respectfully, but it's also possible, and it's really a fine line, I think, to do it really poorly. And then you run into a whole slew of other issues. And I think that applies, I mean, that latter part applies across the board to sort of how one would make a respectful video or take respectful photos about something. And with games, it's complicated because you always do have to consider, as people are playing every step of the game, what is the message that they're taking away? And for us, right, it's very important that we are on point about exactly what we're trying to say.
Yeah, that definitely resonates with some of the things that I've found in terms of, again, you sort of have to continue experimenting with it until something fits. And if you don't, then it seems like it will be much more difficult to actually sort of bring it into being as a game. It might then not be the best version of what you can design or make. So one of the things that maybe I touched on at the end, and that sort of applied to the suggestions that I've made, is that game designers and sort of the making of games is both something is maybe a skill that doesn't exist in every newsroom, obviously, and maybe it shouldn't, but it does ask this. It does beg the question for me, you know, should the role of people journalists in newsrooms change, and in what ways, and should there be game designers in newsrooms as there is, you know, at BuzzFeed? Should there not, and in what ways? And I was hoping that Heather, I know that you've done some work rethinking a little bit what newsrooms need in terms of skills. And I was wondering if maybe you could both talk about that. But generally, from all three of you, I'm wondering, you know, how do you see do you see this as something that is a requisite, or this mindset is requisite to newsrooms? Is this something that points to a changing news landscape or a changing set of roles in the newsroom?
Could I ask a question first?
Sure.
So I'm having a little bit of a hard time thinking about how to answer these questions because I don't have a sense of who's in the audience.
That's a great question.
Are you journalists?
A couple journalists.
I know you have to be here. I know you because you were a former student. I don't know anybody else. I know you. I know why you're interested, but like, am I talking to game designers? Am I talking to journalists? Help me out here. Journalists. So game language is not, okay, that's helpful, right?
That's useful.
What was the question?
Oh, just about the roles of game designers or the roles in the newsroom.
I mean, I think it's a really tough question, so I'm going to kind of come at it slightly sideways. I mean, one of the big mistakes that I've seen get made when people outside of the game world get interested in making games is they make really lousy games. So are you guys familiar with the serious games movement? Okay, so for those of you who are not, when was this? Maybe 10 years ago, 12 years ago, there sort of was this, hey, you know what, games can be more than entertainment. Let's start a serious games movement. There's a conference called Games for Change. Within a few years, and now it's like this big thing, and it's flooded by nonprofits from all over the world all the time, and what you saw happen is educators descended on it and nonprofits descended on it, is that they were like, oh, kids like games. Games are really fun. We're gonna make games, and this is the thing we're trying to get across. This is our content, and we're just gonna hammer that shit in, right? We're gonna get the content into the game and put it out there, because it's a game, people are gonna like it, and they made a bunch of lousy games and nobody played it, and all of the interesting people who were in that space left because nothing interesting was happening. So I'm gonna answer your question slightly sideways by saying, if you are going to go about making games, you don't want to get a bunch of people who don't understand anything about game design doing it. So, for example, like your first question, you know, games as a medium, one of my favorite thinkers about games is a guy named Frank Lance, who's been a big influence on me, and he is the director of the NYU Game Center, and he will say games are not a medium, because a medium is me trying to tell you something. But what games are is a space that allow for unexpected and interesting things to emerge. So I would say, like, even just that as a mindset is not something you're really going to find in a newsroom. So if a newsroom is going to want to make a game or a playable model or some kind of toy, I would think that, yes, they definitely want to have game designers around.
I think we all agree about it. It's funny, so I'm making a game at work right now, right? And one of the first things, I'd gone to Games for Change a few years ago to sort of absorb what was happening in the serious games movement. For anyone who's interested in this conference, early registration ends this Friday. So I got a notification this morning. But what was amazing is that's where I met Ian Bogost, who is a sort of renowned game designer, and he has himself created a studio that has made many serious games, some of which, like Heather has said, and like he himself recognizes, were terrible games, right? Like, they tried to really just shove concepts that they wanted children to learn, even in that sort of case, into, like, I think the example of a game that he even talked about at the conference was a game, I think, that they made called Fat World.
Yeah.
In which
your
goal was to be a child running around this town trying to figure out, like, what was the most healthiest thing you could eat. Mm. And, like, how much time you needed to spend, like, exercising. And, like, no one played this game. Even though, you know, it was, like, very directed at trying to solve a problem and, like, get kids interested. So the first thing I did when I thought to myself, well, we have, like, a really good opportunity with an investigation that we're doing right now, and I really want to make a game. It's something that I've been on the lookout for, the like, just the right story with exactly what I need to help people sort of have a complex system that they can explore themselves. It's not so complex that they can't understand it, and they can learn things as they're doing this for themselves, right? And we had Ian come to the office. We talked to him about sort of, like, how should we approach this game in a way that makes sense, right? And the advice that he gave us right at the outset was sort of invaluable to everything that we've done ever since. I agree with what Heather's saying, right? Like, you can't just hire a bunch of game people and then say go, right? You have to sort of, like, work together, know, like, why you're doing it, and not sort of just, like, in the way where currently journalists, it's easy for me to say, well, I know I need photography because photography tells great stories, right? Like, it's a different sort of concept, at least for us, though I would love to have, like, a team like Nicole's team work at ProPublica. That would be great.
I was going to say that I completely agree with what was said here. And for our context specifically, which has a lot less, we don't have to build systems that represent the real world. Mm. We don't have to worry about how accurate which word are you is. So we don't have those challenges. And I think that in some ways it makes our jobs easier. In some ways it makes our jobs harder in terms of trying to find the types of formats to build. But I think that the values at stake are really well represented at BuzzFeed. Like, the values that make a good game designer are actually pretty spread out among tech and definitely among edit, in terms of iterating on concepts and making sure that they work, and then nobody creates this, like, monolithic project. Well, maybe the investigative journalism takes, but it's very different. But the actual values of, like, creating something on a shorter time frame, seeing what works, and, like, kind of building on that as you go and making it more fun and making it more accessible as you move forward, that's a core value to a game designer. And I think that being shared across the company has been really instrumental in making it so that we're not just having, no one's sitting around and saying, well, if it's a game, it'll be fun, and then waiting for fun to happen. It's more like we had to, like, chase it down.
I think maybe it's worth mentioning something. Another game designer who I really admire, Eric Zimmerman, you know, he gives this great talk now called Games Are Not Good For You, where he just says, you know, games are an aesthetic form like anything else, and this idea that, like, no, games are going to save the world, or games are this sort of great thing. Most games work because there's something subversive about them, or you're doing something mischievous or something you're not really supposed to do. So I just think that's kind of worth throwing out there. And then, Jane, you should jump in on this, but I did a collaboration with two game designers a couple years back on a Knight-funded project where we were trying to do this thing. I'm a journalist working with two game designers, and we ran into a lot of problems. I mean, the culture of game design is very, very different than the culture of journalism. Accuracy versus abstraction was, like, we fought, like, for real, like, problems, fighting, because they'd be like, well, we have to abstract it, and I'd be like, you can't abstract it, and they'd be like, everything's an abstraction, you know, it just was, but no, accuracy is, you know. The other way I sort of describe it is, you know, they would say something, I'd say, no, but, and then, you know, they would, when they talked amongst themselves, the designers, everything was yes and, so I've come to sort of think of it as the no but versus the yes and culture. And is there a way, I do think there's a way that those two things can complement each other, but they are kind, it's kind of this tension point that you can't pretend doesn't exist. Were there any other main big things. I'm trying to think of other things that were tough as we tried to bring it together. Jane was one of our designers in that class. Nothing? I don't mean to put you on the spot.
I might need to find me after.
We can go back to it. Well, maybe on sort of a note that I was thinking about, maybe one of these points of tension is I sort of found, you know, at BuzzFeed and other places, this idea of playtesting, using metrics and using sort of audience feedback as a way of shaping products was both interesting and very sort of playful in its own right. But at the same time, I wondered if some might consider this a violation. Like when I personally found out that many advertising models in the regular mobile games market are based on sort of knowing exactly when you pick up your phone to play, knowing how many times you play, knowing in what ways you play, and similarly see that as something that is could be both a strength in taking this approach, but also could be seen as a sort of form of monitoring or of knowing too much about your audience. I don't know, it was something that I sort of battled with, and I wondered if that's another place for this tension where sort of the issues of privacy go up against the issues of testing and how those might be resolved, how they maybe are resolved in BuzzFeed's case, or if maybe that's just me getting too paranoid. I'm just wondering.
I don't think you're too paranoid. But I think that questions around privacy, I know that BuzzFeed takes privacy very seriously, and there isn't much that we can, for games that are of more serious nature, it's probably more of a concern, but I know that that's always a line that you have to walk no matter what you produce in tech, and it's not just games. In terms of it being a violation, I think that that's a worthwhile discussion. There's never going to be clear boundaries around a discussion, because on one hand you want to make something that people enjoy playing, and a lot of times you can create something that's more enjoyable to play from having data of like how long do people normally play. If they normally play for 2 minutes, we don't want a session to last for 5 minutes. We want it to be a short thing that they can get everything that they want out of it and then like get off the train platform or whatever they're waiting for. So I think that that's always, I don't think you're paranoid, and I think it's a great point, but I think it's, a lot of that is like having to trust the expertise of people who do study privacy data and like taking their advice where needed.
I mean, one of the interesting things, the budget hero game that was up there, was anybody familiar with that game? So it was, you had to balance the budget. And you know, one of the things games can be really good at is cause and effect. So I think that's like kind of a classic example. If I put less money into Social Security, I get more money to this. You know, it's pretty simple. And Dave Rejeski, one of the guys who made it, you know, he says one of the most interesting things about the experience of making that game was what they got off the back end. That they could actually measure how many times people were playing and see how they played it different. So, you know, impact is a big issue in journalism. Now everybody's trying to measure impact. And I would say that's probably another thing in the plus side of thinking about games, is that you can actually begin to measure how people's opinions are changing based on how they play the game. Because like in any MMO or any game that you play over the internet, they're collecting every single step that you do. And yeah, the hornet's nest of privacy is like a whole other topic, yeah. I feel like.
Well, it's actually interesting that the Budget Hero, I interviewed Budget Hero, actually had its own reporter. Yeah. Dave Gustafson, who used the data, he was a data journalist, and he sort of used the data to zero in on people and then would interview them about the decisions they made, yeah, about their lives, etc. And it was a really interesting, he said it was a really interesting way of getting data that was much more complete than, yeah. He said he never had a data set he could zoom in and out of so easily as that one. And I asked throughout the report, you know, why aren't more journalistic institutions making those articles based on the data? I mean, you know, similarly, the Dialect Quiz, I think, produced an article or two out of the Times about how successful the Dialect Quiz was and some of the responses people had. So it seems like an interesting potential future avenue for the creation of further content, but it's also something that I think brings up those questions. So it's complicated one.
Well, to make Budget Hero sound a little less creepy, too.
Oh, no, it's great.
It was optional for anyone who played the game to be able to put in their name and contact information, as well as give demographics, but it wasn't required to play.
And I think the way that Dave got access to it was through the Public Insight Network. So there was one other layer of abstraction there, where he was contacting people that not only were volunteering to play the game, but were doing it through a network that actually, you know, allows for people to do interviews with them and is open to being asked questions, etc. So that's a good point.
Yeah. It wasn't as if somehow Budget Hero figured out exactly who you were.
No. Though if they did, that'd be an interesting game in and of itself. So I have only sort of two last questions. And they're big questions and personal pet projects of mine. One of the things that I found talking to a lot of people at a wide variety of institutions was this issue of preservation kept coming up. That when I would ask, you know, I spoke to people at the Gotham Gazette who had made a series of news games back in the early to mid 2000s, and those games were no longer available. Same thing with the St. Petersburg Times, or it was the Florida Sun Sentinel. It's escaping me right now. I guess I'm interested in how, you know, this issue of preservation, especially because some of this content is, you know, not built in ways that it could be archived via the Internet Archive or anything like that. Is this something that's a concern to practicing journalists? Is this something that should be preserved? Is the process of iterating and changing sort of mean that you have to throw away a lot of that preserved content? Or is this something that should be a concern for journalists, you know, how to save these experiments, these games that are being published, even as technologies change, as ways of producing change, etc.
I mean, this question of preservation, I think, is bigger than games.
Yeah.
So my sort of main job at ProPublica is, my title is News Apps Developer, but basically what I do is anywhere from writing an article to designing and developing interactive graphics, data visualization. And that entire sphere of journalism right now is trying to figure out, well, how do we even archive stuff that we made in 2007 that used Flash, which we don't use anymore, and the technology has changed, people's computers have changed, a bunch of the stuff that people made, you know, just like 5 years ago don't work, and how much resources do we have now to make it work again, and then to make it work forever into the future, right? And I don't know that people have yet come up with a perfect solution, but I know that there has been a lot of talk about, well, what is good enough, right? Is it good enough to preserve it historically in the sense that we make some sort of video or playbackable experience in which you can watch how it was meant to be used? Or is there some sort of technological solution for us? And the way we thought about it is, hypothetically, right, you could host every game essentially on a like a little tiny computer that you buy off the internet, not physical, but digital, and then keep that computer in the state of time in which your game or interactive existed. But I don't know what sort of the resource costs to that are if you were to do that for every project. And there's a lot of, you know, outside of games, interactives that come out every single day, so.
Nice to start. All right, last question is purely selfish, which is that I was interested in your feedback on the suggestions that I make in the report. Do you think that I'm going in the right direction? Do you have anything you want to add as suggestions to this audience in terms of taking this playful approach? I can bring it up again.
Yeah, I was like, I need but, a quick review.
Yeah, here, I'll do that. But yeah, I would be interested in sort of what overall suggestions about taking this approach would be from the three of you as, you know, sort of true experts as opposed to observers in the field. So here, I'll turn that towards you, but you know,
well,
this
I would
idea.
Just suggest maybe it's worth thinking about, and I would love to hear what you guys thought about this as well as you, but we've sort of skimmed over it but didn't really get that deep into what are games good for. And I would feel funny jumping to this without in some ways going into that a little bit
Absolutely.
More deeply.
Yeah.
So what are games good for?
Yeah, I mean, I just feel like we before you could even say, you know, what your technical suggestions are, why would you do this thing?
Yeah.
And I feel like we probably all have somewhat different answers, so I just would be curious to go into that a little bit more.
Well, I think it's if you think of games as a media, it's this is such a cop-out answer, but it's like, what are books good for? What's television good for? It's like everything, but also games aren't good for you intrinsically, as you know, Eric Zimmer would say.
He would say they are. Never mind, go ahead.
Okay. I don't want to speak out for Eric Zimmerman. The classic analogy here is like games are good for representing systems, and therefore they're good for representing complex problems and like teaching you how to navigate and create your own solutions and kind of like intuit a larger system. But games are also good for lots of other things. So games are also good for expressing identity. There's a whole movement within games right now, like alternative games, little personal games that are especially popular among people who are from more marginalized backgrounds using formats like Twine. Mm-hmm. So the crux of it, interactivity allows people to express things that at a level of abstraction from your personal identity. And so I think games are particularly good for saying, hey, you're not you right now. Mm-hmm. You're, you know, whatever the system's asking you to be, or whatever, whoever you want to be for approaching the system. And they're good for allowing people to kind of step outside themselves. And that's the whole magic circle concept. It's like games 101, but that's what the games are good for.
Yeah, well, you know, it's interesting because thinking about the types of games that come out of BuzzFeed for you guys, right? Like, mm-hmm. I could never make those games at ProPublica because it would be hard for me to think of an idea that's like as fun, but as like falls into the investigative category for us. Something that's like, you know, what is your Game of Thrones name or something like that? Which sort of you can just immediately tell from hearing that, right? You know that people are gonna love that and play with it because they want to know, right? I want to put some information about me into a system and get something back that tells me like what my awesome Game of Thrones name could be. And you know, at ProPublica, I feel like what I've been really trying to focus on, and this is also, I mean, it's not a new reason why games are useful, but rather creating empathy in a way that really hits home, because you're not being empathetic because you witnessed something, but because you've experienced something yourself, right? So for me, I want to create some sort of experience in which changes someone's mindset from, oh, I understand that that happens, right, to other people, or I understand that this is something that occurs in the world, into something in which the reader feels more like, now I understand sort of what a person has to go through if they were a part of the system, right? And you know, all of our work, right, is to create outrage so that change happens. So that sort of fits very hand in hand with what games are good for, mm-hmm. as well.
Yeah, I guess you guys are making me feel sort of old, because I feel like I primarily think about what I'm interested in. You know, so there was a lot of research done out of the MacArthur Foundation from their digital media and they had a big digital media and learning initiative where they were really trying to, this is around 2006, 2007 it got started, and they were really some of the first people to be putting money into trying to think about what is it going to mean to be literate in the 21st century, because it'll be different than what it was in the 20th century, let alone the 19th century, and how do people learn today. And you know, some of the early research that came out of that, which I guess is just old hat now to you guys, is, you know, this idea that, you know, games were really great at helping people be better systems thinkers, that when you're playing a game, what was different about playing a video game as opposed to reading a book or watching a movie is that you're engaging directly with the processes of a system. So you're learning about cause and effect all the time. You're learning how every part affects every other part, and you're learning about complexity, which I always think is worth saying is not the opposite of simple, but rather the level of interconnectedness and the fact that all the parts are dynamic and changing all the time. So to me, in a globalized world, we have more complex problems, or what, you know, wicked problems or messy problems, what public policy people, some of the terms public policy people started using in the 70s for these incredibly complex problems like climate change or global poverty or things where it's very hard for the human mind to kind of get around. And I don't think that linear storytelling is very good for helping people understand these kinds of problems, these kind of complex problems that we face today. And a lot of literacy experts talk about how model-based learning is just going to be kind of one of the most important ways that people learn now, because what we have to learn is beyond the reach of a linear story. And we all sort of know probably that linearity is a myth anyway, that things don't happen, this caused this, caused this, caused this. It's much messier than that. So to me, I feel like there's this sort of great chance to develop a new way of helping people grapple with an incredibly complex world, and that journalism ought to be a part of that. And that journalists have not traditionally been that good at helping people understand the underlying systems of the ways things work, or helping us really come to terms with just how complex the problems that we really, really, really have to solve. So I guess I also feel like something's really at stake, more than, oh, it's what the kids are doing or it's fun, but this might really be a way of helping people understand, you know, complexity.
Yeah, I mean, I think, and I want to turn this over to all of you in a second, but one of the things that I want to emphasize personally on this note is one of the reasons that I didn't use the word games is that play opens up a whole set of, at least in my mind, other possibilities of what can be done in this space or in a game space, in the sense that when I think of play, I think of things like mastering skills and working with things over time, iterating over time to really get better at things, be it climate change or producing a good news story. So I think that there's these other, one of the reasons why I'm so fascinated by playful approaches and thinking of this in terms of play and not just as the game system is partially because of that. You know, what can be done if we start thinking of our own practices as journalists, as, I mean, for me, as a scholar, et cetera, in a more playful way. So that's something that I think, you know, is something that I'm searching for and that I hope, you know, reflects in some of my suggestions.
I mean, I feel like these things, like, we all, and this goes back to your very first question, but, you know, these things are really deadly serious. You know, if you look at the role of games and play and cultures all around the world, games are the way that a society prepares people to be citizens. They give them the skills they need as adults. That's like the anthropological reason for the existence of games. I love the example of, I forget which Edward it was, I think it was Edward III. You know, the longbow was invented. He outlawed all sports except archery, right? Because he wanted to build this army, and then he went and fucking almost took over France the next year. So it's like, play games, you know? It's how, you know, the thing that got me interested in games was a saying from anthropology that, show me the games of your children, I'll show you the next 100 years. It's like, the stuff is not frivolous. It's completely serious. Play is how mammals learn.
On that note, maybe we could get some questions of a serious or fun nature from the audience.
So I'll start off because I've got the microphone, and then I'll hand it. I've got a question that I think I'd like to direct principally to Heather, but I'd like to hear everybody's response. We've talked a little bit about how game skills and games designers are getting into the world of journalism. I'd be interested if you see any opportunities or examples of how journalistic skills and journalistic values are they finding their way, are there opportunities for them to find their way into games houses and the self-described kind of games industry?
You mean examples of it, or?
Examples or opportunities. If any of the people who are going through your course were looking at career paths, maybe in newsrooms, but maybe outside, but still being in games.
That's a tough question. I mean, the thing that's coming to my mind is so cliched, I'm sort of embarrassed to say it, but, you know, the idea that journalists are sort of good storytellers, I feel like, is something that I see other industries increasingly being interested in. Whether it's true or not is a whole other question. And I guess I I hope this isn't too self-serving, but I guess I feel like, you know, the sort of insistence on accuracy, mm-hmm. or the sort of ethics of journalism, or the rigor of it, I think would be nice if it found its way into certain avenues. And, you know, I think when you see, you know, like the examples you were giving of the identity games, or there's a really thriving indie game scene, I feel like you're starting to see, but those almost seem like advocacy. I feel like we see a lot of advocacy games. I don't know what you guys would say.
Yeah, I would largely agree. Whenever you talk about the games industry, it's a little hard, just because on one hand you have, you know, Call of Duty 30 or whatever, and on the other hand you have a choose your own adventure game that somebody made in 2 hours and then is sharing it on Twitter to like talk about what it's like to take growth hormone pills every day. So I also this is maybe a little outside my wheelhouse, but what would you say are the journalistic values you would want to see in games? So like, I think is it about accuracy? So a lot of there's an accuracy of the system, and then there's like a truthiness of the experience of something, and I don't think that those are necessarily directly opposed to each other, but I think that games more easily convey the latter than the former, because a lot of times in order to really actually understand the numerical accuracy, because you have to be talking in numbers for that kind of point, to approach that as a player, you had to be an extremely high level player, and to approach it, or you have to like actually crack into the code, and that's like an even another level of difficulty and like inaccessibility of the system. So
the first thought I had was like, no, absolutely not. I can't think of a thing. But I don't know, to just a totally different angle that you guys took is, if we're thinking about like, you know, could journalists who have a mind for or interest in games get a job in the games industry, literally? I would say that there was one experience I had last year which could travel very parallel, which is they're games writers, in which their job on these like AAA huge games that come out that takes like multiple years to make or whatever, right? They actually, you know, video games are paying a lot of attention to exactly what the dialogue is inside of the game to communicate certain things to people, but also to get you, to keep you invested, especially when you're playing games that are 50 to 60 hours long total, right? And I took a games writing class, and it seemed to me the whole sort of atmosphere was like, this is like, how do you figure out what the story is? Yeah. And like, what's the beginning and the middle and the end? And then how do you communicate that to people using dialogue or writing, or, you know, a sense of sort of writing direction, which I think is very parallel to what journalists do.
I found that, at least from the people that I interviewed, the only people treading that line were people that were sort of in both worlds. So I met academics and serious game designers who wanted to be bring in journalists and journalistic accuracy into their products. I met game journalists, people covering it, who then were experimenting as part of their like practices of writing in making games. I think that was actually the case with a journalist in Sweatshop, where he added that dialogue because he just wanted to get a feel of what this was that he's been covering. So it's funny that it seems like the point of entry means that you have to tread those lines right now, and I wonder if that has to remain the same way, or if that instead, you know, it could be something that could, you know, where more people could enter through, you know, in through writing for games or whatever it might be.
So if I'm the bloated owner of a for-profit news organization, how do games earn their keep? Do they earn their keep because they increase my readers' goodwill and loyalty? Do I sell advertising against them? Is anybody in the present climate charging readers to use games? How do I make money?
Well, I mean, a part of the confusion, and again, one of the reasons why I focus so much on play in this report, is that a game making money for a journalistic institution is somewhat difficult, and the sort of full systems that I've found, and please correct me if I'm wrong, often had to be these games that involved multiple journalistic partners and philanthropic organizations. So if you want to make this whole system, often it was quite an expensive endeavor and philanthropically minded in terms of funding. However, if you think about the New York Times crossword puzzle and the app that, well, not the app, but like the website version of that, right? That's a monetized service. You have to pay to a subscription fee. So is that an example of a game being incorporated by a journalistic institution? Well, kind of. And I think that what I have found personally is that depending on sort of where it fell on that features or stock formats model, it's meant to either engender new audiences, different audiences. The New York Times for the World Cup did a spot the ball game, which they had sort of brought over from Europe. And that was meant to bring in a different audience and apparently had some moderate success, you know, a few increased clicks and was, you know, broaden their package. So I think that's where you see it the most, is at trying to do that. And then there have been failures. I spoke to someone from the Gotham Gazette who had received a Knight grant to make a number of serious games for the Gotham Gazette. And she said that it didn't really, when all was said and done, attract the major audiences that they were looking for. She questioned whether that was the case. So one of the things that was emphasized to me literally from my first interview was that there's no perfect formula for games. And that's part of the difficulty in imagining this within a news organization, is I don't know if there's a predictable way to sort of monetize them. I don't know if you guys want to add to that.
Thank you all for coming here, by the way. I just want to say it's been fantastic hearing this discussion. So I'm kind of curious how news organizations see games or more engaged content, however you want to approach it rhetorically, how they see that as proprietary, because within news organizations, obviously, original reporting or data research can be a huge investment, but there's still this ethos of showing your work and making it available to the public to build off of. But with games, you can develop an architecture that's pretty easily replicable by a competitor that they can then potentially have a low-cost competition with. So I'm curious, you know, would we see in the future news organizations putting the full architecture of a game on GitHub, or is that too proprietary and they want to hold back on that?
I have seen both sides of that argument, as far as I can tell. I know Mother Jones has, for their sort of their graphics and development department, they have their quiz format available. Now, it's hard to understand outside the context of that company, and they even say that in their sort of explanation, but it is available on their GitHub page. The NPR visuals team similarly has a number of their sort of formats available. I think it really depends on the organization. I personally, if I could put on my advocate hat, think it should be happening more. And I think that it would be valuable for those smaller news organizations to be able to take and use. I don't know, not being a working journalist, if that is something that is concerning to people at BuzzFeed, to people at ProPublica when your game is developed, but it's something that I would like to see personally, because I think there's, if everyone makes quizzes, they're gonna look different, and the architecture of it is one thing, but making it fit with the brand and the culture of a particular publication or organization is going to be a completely different thing. And in my mind, that latter issue is going to be a bigger hurdle than the architectural issue.
I don't remember what the term was, Max, that you used on one of your slides when you were differentiating two types of games. And it was one of them, the example was the New York Times dialect quiz. And then the other one was a BuzzFeed quiz.
So features was dialect quiz.
Yeah.
Stock formats was the
BuzzFeed. So features and stock formats. So I think this is a really interesting way to think about this question, which is when you come to stock formats, right, like everybody can understand pretty easily the concept of a quiz that we've seen ever since sort of magazines, I feel like, made them really popular, which is like start here and then like make some decisions and then you end up here. And it's not even quite choose your own adventure. It's just like, what bucket do you fall into? Like, how do you categorize yourself or something like that? And there are great sort of tools already out there for anyone to make that kind of game. And I think the real value there, right, is people are going to make different games just because they don't want, you know, even if we sort of are late to reporting something, we never want to say, like, exactly as the New York Times reported it, this is what we're going to report, right? So there's sort of a journalism competitive edge value add situation going on in sort of that category. And also, if your news organization is really sort of pioneering the tool, you know, like BuzzFeed, and like constantly thinking about creative ways to use it, I think you'll always sort of stay ahead there. But then when we come to the features version, there's sort of a lot of messy problems that come with this. So at ProPublica, we try to open source things a lot. And I know that NPR, their mantra is sort of like, everything is open sourced. And the problem with other journalists like stealing your open source and making something that's gonna put you down is like, there's so many sort of steps that have to come in between, which is one, they have to have developers who work for the newsroom who would even be able to technically implement such a thing, right? And then two, their resources have to be used for that purpose as opposed to some other purpose. And the other thing is open sourcing code, just like from the database stuff that we do and trying to make things that other people can use, open sourcing code is very different than putting all of your code on the internet. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, what people do is the latter. They just put all of their code on the internet, and then it's very hard for someone else, another developer, to be like, oh my god, I can just download this and use it. Like, that never happens. Mm-hmm. So if you open source it, you already know, and if you're gonna do it responsibly, you already know I want other people to use this. That's my goal in doing open source well, and putting it up in a way where I give you the instructions on literally how to use this, as opposed to, here, just dig through all the stuff I wrote, right? So like all of that taking into account, right? And then you get to this beautiful feature game that the New York Times made, the dialect quiz, right? Came about because one of the, like, you know, all of this data was basically someone's entire sort of like PhD research, right? That he's been doing for over a year, and then he got hired at the New York Times after they made this. And it's like, how do you even replicate that for another organization unless you have a totally separate original idea that you come up with or find someone who's already been doing that research, right? And would you want to make something that looked identical to it? Because it's already so associated in my mind with the New York Times dialect quiz, where if I saw it again, I'd be like, oh, isn't this the New York Times dialect quiz? So it's very complicated. So I think a lot of it is, I'm much less worried that if I were to responsibly open source something, right, what I want is for other people to use it all the time. And I think that's what Mother Jones tries to do really well. Their GitHub repos are extremely well documented. There's tons of examples of how it's been used, tons of examples of literally like each step you could take. And they test it all on their reporters, right, as guinea pigs. And so, you know, I think it's just at a point right now also where journalists are working hard to do innovative stuff online, and the number of people is so small at the current moment that everyone is trying to help each other learn so that we're all like elevated, right? Yeah. So yeah, I'm not that worried about it is basically my long-winded answer.
and speaking to one last comment, speaking to this question of how we might be rethinking newsrooms, I think that what you're also talking about in terms of that New York Times example is maybe a new skill set. I know not here, but if you're looking at the digital humanities over in Comp Lit, one of the things they're talking about a lot is the skill of finding a good data set, right? And I think that might be something to think about in terms of both what the skill set some journalists may require, and maybe ones that want to adopt this sort of playful approach are going to need to sort of cultivate finding the next dialect quiz data set, wherever it may be, because they're out there, but they're not easy to find. They have to be investigated and found and used in their own way as well. Yeah.
So much of the passion that people have for news stories is expressed in the comment feed, often very snarky comments in that news feed. And I wondered if there's been interest in any of your organizations of how do you channel that kind of snarkiness into something, whether it's through a game or otherwise, into something that really engages people in a conversation that's at a much higher level.
I feel like I don't know how to address the snarkiness part specifically, but I do think that one thing that games can be really good at is engaging people and creating a community sense. I mean, most games are social. There's so much talk and images in people's head of like that lone guy in front of his video game, but most games are pretty highly social. So I would think that. But this is not what you're interested in. You're interested in the snark specifically.
It's like, how do you harness the snark into
the energy that people put in?
Well, that's
if I post a comment about politics, I'm going to get a feed, you know,
right.
30 comments on it. And I'm wondering who's looking at channeling that energy.
Well, I think for me, what's interesting about that question is, so I just finished some research kind of about all of this, so I'm just reporting on what I heard. So I think games are probably great at harnessing that energy that we get in the comment section, but one thing that I did hear a lot of journalists being nervous about games is that, you know, really good game designers know that the best thing that's going to happen in their game was something they could never have anticipated. That's almost like a mark of good game design is what emerges, and that is something that makes journalists really, really nervous, because then if you're making a good game, you're sort of inherently leaving it open that you're not in control of what's going to happen in that space. So it's a rich.
Also, whether part of the question here is whether you're migrating journalists into tool makers of a certain kind, template makers, people who create the context for interaction, but really give it to the others to approximate their own truth.
I mean, I think it's such an interesting thing to be happening, to think about at this moment as journalists in general are struggling with no longer being as in as much control as they were a generation ago or used to be, and then here's this new medium that's like, give it up. If you do it right, you've lost all control.
I think we're going to have to close it from here, but I want to thank everyone for coming, especially our three panelists, and thank the Tau Center for giving me this opportunity to write this report, and thank you all for attending. And I'll be around to answer any further questions, and that's about it. Thank you so much for coming.